Can you see the screen?
Yes.
महाकाय सूर्यकोटिसमप्लव निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा सरस्वती नमस्तुभ्यं वरदे कामरूपिणी विद्यारम्भं करिष्यामि सिद्धिर्भवतु मे सदा वागस्थाविव संपृक्तौ वागस्थः प्रतिपत्तये जगतः पितरौ वन्दे पार्वती परमेश्वरौ धातु ब्रह्मैव संप्रोक्तो जीव आख्यातमुच्यते प्रकृतिकृत्सदन्तादिर्धातुब्रह्मात्मने नमः. So we are looking at Dhal Sandhi. So I think we saw the Parasavarna. We didn't see the Parasavarna, but I'd mentioned Parasavarna. We saw the when a khar letter follows jal, when a khar letter follows jal, we get a char adesha. The most proximate to the pronunciation sthana and prayatna. The sthana and prayatna should be considered when you take the adesha. So char letters, char is a pratyahara from the Maheshwara Sutras, and whatever is included in char, we should see which is the closest to the jhal letter when replacing it when followed by a khar letter. An example we saw was vakcha becomes vagcha, then tyakta. These are the adeshas. Give me one second, please. Tatkim sarva vitsu, these are the sandhis given, the exercise to solve those. Like tasmat paraha will become tasmad paraha. When you break the sandhi, it will come back to ta. Da and ta both are it's an optional sandhi where you get marud or marud. Similarly, tasmat or tasmad. But based on what follows, it can change. And we saw this optional sandhi, the jhalam char adesha, at the end when there is an avasana, when there is a pause. So ramad or ramat, based on what follows, but then when you pronounce ramad, declension, ramad is a panchami, when you pronounce that, generally you will not get ramad at the end, but if you do get, then you can have ramat or ramad. Similarly, Virat or Virat. So we have seen this Parasavarna Sandhi, where Anuswara, if an Anuswara is there, Anuswara, which we have seen, Anuswara can be due to a Makara at the end of the Pada, or due to a Nakara or a Makara within the Pada when followed by a Jal letter. So that Anuswara now gets a Parasavarna Adesha. Parasavarna Adesha means what Para is, what follows. And when yai follows, yai is, this sandhi says that whenever a yai letter follows, and yai is anything except for a, any consonant except for a hakara. So any consonant except for a hakara, when it follows, the anuswara can optionally become, I think anuswara se parasavarna, anuswara can become the parasavarna, means the savarna of a yai letter. Yai letter is any consonant except for hakara, which means it can be any of the 25 class consonants or the aspirates or sibilants. Now, some of these have a savarna, some of these don't. The class consonants, the varga, panchama is a savarna for anuswara if it is a class consonant that follows. So, ka varga, pa varga, any of these varga letters follow, then it will become a varga panchama of the anuswara. And again, now this is a sandhi which is mandatory, but then based on other rules, it can become optional. So parasavarnaha for anuswara, for class consonants, is the varga panchama. For refa, vakara and yakara, ya, not refa, ya, va, ra, la, among them, refa does not have the, among the aspirates, the refa does not have a savarna, so anuswara will remain as will be pronounced as makara. But ya, va and la, they yakara, vakara and lakara, they will have a nasalized yakara, nasalized vakara or nasalized lakara as the pronunciation when followed by a particular yakara, vakara, respective letter, then this anuswara will have a similar pronunciation as the yakara, vakara or lakara which is nasalized. Then shakara, shakara and sakara, they also do not have a an equivalent nasalization for them. So therefore, makara is the pronunciation. And then in Vedas, it may be different based on the Pratishakya. I had mentioned this earlier as an answer to a question. So sham plus ka shanka. We have seen these examples, I think. Sanyati, samvadaha, sanlakshanam. So sanyati. This yakara becomes with an andra. When you write it, you will show it with ardha chandra. Yakara followed by ardha chandra is a pronunciation for anuswara when followed by yakara. Sanyati, samvadaha, vakara becomes nasalized. Sanlakshanaha, lakara becomes nasalized instead of the anuswara. Now this is optional sandhi, as in due to, I think, vibhasha va. In this sutra itself there may be a anuvrutti, and it says that makes it optional. So therefore I think it's not optional. What happens is that either you get an ardha chandra or you get an anuswara. So ardha chandra, no, it's an optional sandhi. So you'll get either sanyati or sanyati. And sanyati is just nasalization. The anuswara alone is pronounced, but this yakara, which is nasalized, that is taken as an option by this sutra, by parasavarna adesha, then you will get sanyati. The yakara, there is a stress on that because yakara is doubled. In the other option, where you don't take the option of this, as in you don't take the this sandhi, parasavarna sandhi, but you keep it as optional and you don't utilize the option, then it remains anuswara. But in chanting, it's preferable to you utilize the mandatory. The sandhi has a mandate, and use this sandhi and make a parasavarna. Therefore you get samvadaha, sanyati, sanlakshanam. The chanting is better, and you see that in Vedic chanting at least, all sandhis are mandatory. Most of the sandhis are mandatory, not all. I'll not say all, because Veda has its own rules. But in other chantings also, if you bring down the chanting quality, improves. Bring down the mandate, as though this optional sandhi, we use it by. So this sutra does not. So it says that padanta, this is optional by the next sutra. So if it is at padanta, then it is optional. Anuswara at the end of the pada can remain is an optional parasavarna. It can become parasavarna or it can remain anuswara. I'll skip through the examples. You can go through. There is another sandhi where it says that the ta varga letter, tu, when followed by lakara, will take a parasavarna. Parasavarna is lakara. Lakara is para, so you will get a savarna of lakara. And what is the savarna of lakara for ta varga? It will be lakara or nasalized lakara. So the first four letters, ta, tha, da, dha of the varga, it will be lakara. As for the last one, the ta, tha, da, dha, na, the nakara, nakara will have a nasalized lakara as the replacement. So you'll get, for earlier four letters, dha, tha, dha, dha, when followed by lakara, the replacement is lakara. And for nakara, the replacement is lakara. So you see, tad layaha will become tal layaha. Dakara, tad being a first four of the ta varga, it will become lakara. So you will get tal layaha. But when you are splitting tal layaha, it can be tat layaha, it can be tat tha, thakara. It can be a takara, thakara, dakara or dhakara. But we know that the only possibilities are tat or tad, because the other words do not exist. But in some cases it may be true. We do not know. There may be some words where such sandhis may be possible. So we have to be careful when breaking the sandhi, that other possibilities are there. But when making the sandhi, it will be lakara only. So tallayaha is tadlayaha, or tatlayaha is tallayaha. Shraddhavan labate. So shraddhavan, this nakara will become nasalized lakara due to the parasavarna sandhi, and you get shraddhavan labhate. Udlekha will become ullekha. Hanuman langate will become hanuman langate. See, jahat lakshana. So there is a jahat lakshana. One of the lakshanas, one of the three lakshanas. Jahat lakshana, ajahat lakshana, jahal ajahal lakshana. So jahat ajahal lakshana, the sandhi jahat lakshana will become jahal lakshana. There are three lakshanas in Vedanta that we use. When you take a vachyartha of a word, it is just the literal meaning of the word. But Brahma is not a vachyartha of any word, including the word Brahma. So there you have to do lakshana. What is Brahma? There you have to do lakshana. So it is indirect meaning. So lakshana means indirect, indirection. So in say tattvamasi, in the Mahavakya tattvamasi, the vakyartha also you have to do lakshana as to what tattvamasi, to make this sentence meaningful. You cannot just take it literally. Literal padas on both sides. Tat means Ishvara and Tvam means Jiva. If you take it literally, then Ishvara is Jiva with the Upadhi. So that will not be true. Therefore, you have to do some lakshana. And Jahat is giving up. Jahat is giving up something. Shataranta, giving up something, you make an indirection. And thereby you get Jahat lakshana. You drop the Upadhis and then you get the equation meaningful. So jahat, this takara by this sandhi will become parasavarna when lakara follows and you get jahal lakshana. So when you pronounce it, you will be saying jahal lakshana, ajahal lakshana. But jahat ajahal lakshana will become jahad. Takara will become takara when followed by akara. So you will get jahad, 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 ajahad, lakshana, jahad, ajahal lakshana. That's how you will get this sandhi. Then there is another sandhi where this is an optional sandhi. Where ka varga, all the varga letters. So when the varga letters follow ka varga, cha varga, ta varga, ta varga, pa varga, when they are followed by a hakara, so any of the class consonants, when they are followed by a hakara, the sandhi is the fourth of the class. This is the fourth of the class because that's the closest in pronunciation to hakara. Hakara hakara. Will when you add to any letter, it will make that as Mahaprana. When you say Mahaprana, as you pronounce the, but make it Mahaprana, so as though there is a pronunciation of Hakara. You make the by saying the by saying Dakara plus Hakara as though. It is not really so. The. Similarly, Ka will become Ka, Kha, Ga, Gha. It will be fourth of the class. Fourth, second and fourth of the class are Mahaprana. But for Hakara, the closest in pronunciation, sthana and prayatna will be the fourth of the class, not the second of the class. So always you will get the fourth of the class as the as the purva savarna. It is a purva savarna. The earlier, the kavargas is the purva letter and its savarna will be the replacement for hakara, for the what the letter that follows in the sandhi. So we have seen that the earlier can be replaced, the later can be replaced, both can be replaced. These are the possible sandhis. So here the later is replaced by the savarna of the earlier, and that being the class consonant, you get the fourth of the class. So dighari will become dighari. So you will get gha instead of hakara, you will get gha. Similarly, ajhina will become ajhina, jhakara you will get, and so on. So this is another sandhi. There is one more sandhi where there is the shakara when preceded by a jai letter and followed by an at. I think at here it will be said as the sutra is given an explanation that at means here. But anyway, even when at follows or and jai precedes, so shakara, shankar shakara, when sandwiched between a jai letter, meaning a class consonant, and then when an at letter follows, then shakara can optionally become chakara. When it becomes chakara, then optionally, then the pronunciation tat shastram, for example, tat shastram will become tat shastram. And there is a chakara which will precede. In this case also, there will be chakara preceding. But I am just mentioning this. We don't need to look at this right now. When we come to the sandhi, while pronunciation itself, we tell you that cha is not there. It is shakara. If we remember this rule, it will come back to us. So let's not go into detail of the sandhi because there are multiple things that are happening. Even this chakara, shakara preceded by chakara and followed by a, also has similar situation. Like for example, vak shete. So vakshete will become vakshete. It will become chakara. Shakara will become chakara. So just think of a possibility that shakara can sometimes in some sandhis appear as chakara. This is that we need to know. Tat shrunu will become tat shrunu will become tat shrunu. You see these words. So when you split these sandhis, just know that this chakara is another sandhi, that takar has become chakara and shakara has become chakara. So when you split it, you will get such and shabda, that shabda is shabda, and such, the chakara is actually takara. So when shakara becomes chakara, then the earlier letter can also change. It can become chakara. This is the sandhi. There are multiple rules applying, so I am skipping this. I am just mentioning that this is a rule. So these are the hal sandhis. So just to recall, what are the sandhis possible? Ach sandhi and hal sandhi. Vowels, when they come together, there is a sandhi. And either the earlier or later or both can be replaced. They can be replaced by another letter. They can be replaced by the earlier or they can be replaced by the later. And there can be multiple rules applying, and thereby you may get a completely different sounding word, so to say. When you split the words, there is a different pronunciation. When you put them together, it's a different pronunciation. The sandhi is mandatory in a situation where the letters are immediately following. First of all, the letters sandhi is possible only when they are immediately following, and immediately following means in pronunciation, this, when they are sounding it. And these are mandatory. Some places it is mandatory, some places it is optional. The only place it is optional, based on the person, it is on the vivaksha. If the person intends to make the sandhi, he can make the sandhi. Otherwise, if he is taking a pause, he can break the sandhi in a sentence while explaining. But if one is chanting a quarter of a verse, or it is in a samasa, a compound, or it is between a upasarga prefix and another word, Then it is a mandatory sandhi. For a vivaksha, when you are explaining something as a sentence, when you are talking something, then sandhis are optional. Then there is a visarga sandhi, which is also part of hal sandhi, consonant sandhi. But the laghu prakriya, the Kaumudi Grantha is treated as a separate sandhi, because there are quite a lot of rules applying, and through sutras it is very difficult to explain the sandhis. So we have seen in various cases, punah punaha, that those kind of sandhis, punah punaha, or Arjuna uvacha, where there is a visarga lopa. So these are the places where you get these sandhis, and since multiple adeshas are there, something namo namah sandhi. So these kind of sandhis are possible, and we give them with an example. We try to understand that sandhi. And then we saw the consonant sandhi, and where there can be an anus, something can become the makara or nakara, within the pada can become an anuswara, at the end of the pada makara can become anuswara, then anuswara itself can become pada savarna when a yai letter follows, any consonant except for hakara follows. Then we saw when a lot of places we saw jal letter gets an adesha. Jal are the except for the fifth of the rather fourth, third, second, first, and the sibilants, they get a replacement jal when at the end of the pada they are replaced by a jashtom. We saw jashtom, we saw murdhanyatom, the nakara becoming nakara. We saw in some places when a refa or a shanmukh shakara follow precedes, then and it is sandwiched by at. Ka varga letter, pa varga letter, or a num agama, some kind of an agama, when some kind of a nakara is sandwiched in between, then this they can take natvam as in it, the nakara will become nakara. That is a possibility. We saw shatvam, shakara can become shakara, the shankar shakara can become a murdhanya shakara, talavya shakara can become murdhanya, meaning the Shankar Shakara can become a Shanmukh Shakara. That's another possibility we saw. And then based on whether the pada itself has multiple definitions, so within the derivation also it is possible. So within the word or across words, we saw more sandhis across words than within the word, because we look at the fully derived word, we are not looking at derivations. Then we looked at another sandhi where some dhatus are there, and then the dhatu Shakara or Shakara can become Shanmukh Shakara, that's another possibility, and so on. So there are a lot of sandhis where based on what follows, based on which dhatu it is or which dhatu it isn't. Like for example, dhakara is another adesha we saw in buddhi, and then the earlier letter becoming taking some char or jash. So these kind of possibilities we saw, these are hal sandhis. Now we look at Panchavritti. I forgot to download the book. I think I hope I have it here. Otherwise, I'll quickly download the book. I think it will be in. It should be in on the wall itself. I have it somewhere, I don't remember where I have stored it, so just give me a moment. But anyway, I'll just mention what's Panchavritti. There are five ways to derive a word, that is called as Vritti. Vritti is a way to derive a word. So thereby, just a second, Panchavritti is here, do you have Panchavritti here? So there are five ways to derive a noun. And that is called a vritti, is a way you derive something. So we say vyutpatti for a word, or a, we say vritti of a compound or something like that. So that's how we use the word vritti or vyutpatti also. And here vritti has a technical meaning as how it is derived, how a noun is derived here in this place. In the word panchavritti, panchavritti is five vrittis. And we look at this, there's a book by Veda Michika ji. I'll just download it. So these five vrittis are they are kridanta, taditanta, samasa, ekashesha. So there, and derived roots also. There are five ways to derive something. Even in Sanskrit, you can derive. Actually, it is reverse engineered. The words are taken, and whatever is common in the words, they are taken out as pratyayas, whether as a suffix which is at the end or it is in the middle some suffix. So there can be multiple suffixes. This is how Panini Maharshi reverse engineered all the words into something called as dhatus, the basic building block. And there are two views whether as to a basic building block can be something from which all words can be derived, or there are some views saying that the some words are cannot be derived. So one view says that all words are derivable from dhatus. The other says that some words are not derivable from dhatus. They are as they are. They are just the way they are. So, based on that, we have the derived ways also. And in the derived way, when whether everything can be derived and some cannot be. Of course, some cannot be shown to be derived. They will be saying that either it is like that, or they will say that it is derived from some pratyaya which is not seen here. Some pratyaya is imagined, so that way also it is seen that a particular word, even it is called something called as a nipata. Nipata is, this is how the word is, that's it. It cannot be derived. Like chaka, cha, if you say cha meaning and, so ramascha, lakshmanascha. So when you say ramaha cha, lakshmanaha cha, what is that cha? That cha does not have a dhatu which can be shown. So you say it is a nipata, that's how the word is. And the five vrittis we look at. Let's see book. Okay, so let me open the book. Okay, so this is the book. Called Panchavritti. So derivation is possible from a dhatu. So dhatu plus a krit pratyaya. Dhatu plus a krit pratyaya. Okay. So here dhatu plus a krit pratyaya. Varaha. So panchavrittis. Dhatu plus a krut pratyaya. Krut pratyaya will give a krudanta pada. By the sandhi, you see this takara has become dakara and anta, the word is anta. So krut ante yasya, that which has a krut pratyaya in its end is a krudanta pada. So this is a krudanta pada. This is one of the vrittis. Then you have, so you can derive a noun. So basically what you will get is, you will get a krudanta pratipadika. And when you pratipadika, and when you add this, when you decline it with a supratya, you will get a krudanta pada. So you will get a krudanta pratipadika when you add a krut pratyaya to a dhatu. So you have derived a noun from a dhatu. From a verbal base, you have derived a noun. Then other places, ways to derive is from a noun itself. So from a noun, from a pratipadika, you add a, from a noun base. Pratipadika is a noun base. So you have derived a noun base from a verbal base by adding a krut pratyaya earlier in a krut vritti, in a krudanta vritti. So you will get a krudanta pratipadika, a krudanta noun base. For this noun base, then you can add a supratya, which is true for any noun. Like Rama is a pratipadika, you add supratya to declare Ramaha, Ramo, Ramaha. Similarly here, dhatu plus krut pratya will become a noun base pratipadika, which you can decline as a noun by adding supratya. So what other pratipadika is possible? A pratipadika plus a taddhita pratya. Taddhita pratya will give you another pratipadika. This will be called as a taddhita vritti. Taddhita pratipadika, the explanation given for how it is derived, that explanation statement in Sanskrit is called a vritti. So you will see and explanation statement of what? Of derivation. So dhatu plus krut pratyaya, if I mention how it is derived and the meaning of that krut pratyaya in a Sanskrit sentence, that becomes a vritti, krudanta vritti. And pratipadika plus taddhita pratyaya, you will get a taddhita pratyaya, I'll just come to taddhita. Say pratipadika plus pratipadika. Pratipadika plus another pratipadika, which is a sambandha. Pratipadika is a sambandha. Like in Shashti, Shashti Vishwa, Ramasya Putra or Dasharatasya Putraha Ramaha. Son of Dasharata is Rama. This is a vritti. Now this complete vritti can be given as a compound also. Dasharata Putraha. So two pratipadika, Dasharatasya, which is a vritti. Now vritti will be Dasharatasya Putra. So first pratipadika is Dasharataha plus sixth case pratyaya. And then another pratipadika, another noun, which is Putraha. Putra pratipadika plus the first case suffix, supratya. So that is my vritti. The samasa vritti, it will be called as a compound, a samasa. Samasa vritti will be pratipadika and a pratipadika. So another pratipadika is derived from two pratipadikas. When I derive the pratipadika from two or more also is possible. So two or more pratipadikas, then I get a another pratipadika. So that is called a samasa, compound. And what is that? That's a relation between two pratipadikas, or actually it is a relation between two nouns, two fully declined padas. So therefore they are relation between two nouns. So I can say Ramasya Putraha or Dasharatasya Putraha can be said as Putra, or it can be any kind of a relation. The basic relation is Tasya Idam. Tasya Idam is this belongs to that. Or Sambandhi. Sambandha is the Rishashti. So a Shashti is expressed in a compound as a relation. So Dasharata Sambandhi, if I have to say, then that will become a Vritti. Taddhita Vritti, it can become a Samasa by saying that two things, two nouns are related. So I say Dasharataha and Putra, there is a connection. Dasharatasya Putra. So Putra is as not a son. Putra is a word. A word Putra has a connection to the word Dasharata. And what is that relation? That is a Shashti by saying Dasharatasya Putraha. It is a connection. And what connection? Then you take the meaning. Dasharata is this king, and then Putra is means son. So his son. So the vritti in English will be his son. Tasya Putraha. So thereby you will get, so two ways I can put this now. Tasya Putraha, I can keep the word Putraha in the, along with Dasharataha. So I can say Dasharata and Putra, when I keep them together, then that relation which is expressed keeping both the words, that will become a compound and I'll get a samasa vritti, samasa. So I'll just remove this krudanta, this is a samasa vritti, this taddita, and this samasa in the same relation I may be able to as per the grammar's rules, I may be able to give the same relation without keeping the word by dropping the second word with a pratyaya. So the tasya putraha, the relation tasya putraha or sambandhi, whatever that sambandhi, tasya putraha or tasya patni also, all these relations can be given with a pratyaya. And when that is done, the second word is dropped and instead of pratyaya is used to convey the relation, then that will be called as a taddhita pratyaya, and that the resultant word will be called as a taddhita shabda. That's another vritti. Taddhita vritti will lead to a taddhita word, and the derivation is a pratipadika, noun base to which you will add a taddhita pratyaya in the meaning of some kind of a sambandha to that noun, and that will be called as a taddhita vritti. So for example here, let's say this dhatu plus pratyaya, any word that is, most of the words are krudanta words where you can trace back the dhatu, go back to the, so let's say the even the word karaka itself will be, there is a karaka sambandha here, and krut pratyaya, we can talk of all karakas. So another thing is karakas, any meaning of karakas, but this is a samasa, is a sambandha, it's a samasa, is a sambandha, sambandha, and taddhita is also sambandha because it is between nouns. Now this karakas, in any karakas we saw the kartra karaka, karma karaka, then we saw karana karaka, or we saw in all the karakas meaning whatever we saw, sampradana or panchami for hetau panchami is not a karaka, but karaka will be apadana karaka panchami. So in this karaka meanings we saw, non karakas we saw, so six karaka meanings and one sambandha make seven supratyas categories. So seven vibhaktis, you get seven vibhaktis and one sambodhana which is same as prasama. But karaka meanings are karta, karma, karana, sampradana, apadana, and saptami. In saptami you get adhikarana. So other meanings are also possible, but if karakas you can derive krutpratya, you get a karaka meaning. Others may be possible as some other kind of a samasa or something, but in krudanta you will get dhatu plus krutpratya. And examples are even this karta itself, karta, the word karta itself is an example for the karta, dharta, or all these meanings. So there are a lot of meanings. There can be, say, asana, a word called asana, etc. There are a lot of meanings, and most of the words we see which are not complicated words, as in lot long words, small words can be traced back to dhatus, and thereby that's a krudanta shabda derived with a dhatu and a krut pratyaya. This is the first vritti. Second vritti, pratipadika, and pratipadika when you put together in a sambandha, you get samasa, like dasharatas. Dasharatasya putra will become Dasharata putra. Dasharata putraha. Then, so I am just mentioning pratipadika, although these should not be written. Here it will actually will get kartru. Kartru as a pratipadika. Or dhatru, or let's say dharta or dhatru. Dhatru, I'll say dhatru. Dhatru. Asana, then based on which is the gender, it will be declined in that gender. I need a So then, so pratipadika and pratipadika put together, you get samasa. That's one vritti. it's a sambandha, and example is Dasharatha Putra, for example. Then a third vritti is the when you put the pratipadika and the same meaning as the samasa vritti, like a samasa vritti, any words put together, if you express with a pratyaya in and dropping the next word, you'll get a tadjita vritti, that's also sambandha. For example, Dasharathi, the same word Dasharathi. So Dasharatha plus some kind of a E you see. E is a pratyaya which is actually akara, the last Dasharatha akara. Dasharatha akara has been replaced by ikara, and earlier the akara after the kara has taken a dhirga. Actually it has taken a vriddhi. You have seen the word vriddhi. It has taken a vriddhi. What is called as adi vriddhi. So you in Tadrita, most of the cases you will see what is called as an adi vriddhi. Dasharatha will become Dasharatha. Hiranya will become Hairanya. You see, Ikara's vriddhi is Ai. So you'll get Hiranya will become Hairanya. Dasharatha will become Dasharatha. Akara will become Akara. Ikara will become Aikara. Ukara will become Aukara. So Puru will become Pauru. So Purusha will become Paurusha. Paurusheya. So these kind of words, Paurusheya. Sheya. So these kind of words will be there. So Purusha Sambandhi Paurushe, Dasharatha Sambandhi Dasharati. These are the Taddita Vrittis. The fourth Vritti is if you have a compound like a Samasa where you say, you want to say Mata and Pita. Mata cha Pita cha. That's one Vritti which is called a Dvandva Samasa. Samasas themselves are of various types. So one type of Samasa is called a Dvandva Samasa, where multiple elements, individual elements are put together. So it's just like saying this and that and so 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. So Mata and Pita and Swasa and Bhrata, all these you put together, it will become one Samasa. So if you have Mata and Pita, there are some rules where Mata and Pita, when you make the Samasa, which word should go earlier, whether Pita should go earlier or Mata should go earlier. So you get Mata, so Mata Pitaro. Mata Pitaro is a Samasa. Pitaro Ramaha Ramo. So generally you don't say two Ramas. There may be cases when you may have to address two Ramas where people share the same name. But otherwise you will be saying, you will see this in compounds. You will see the second or plural declension of in a first case or second case or whichever case you see. You will see dual and plural generally in pronouns and in proper nouns. You will see them generally in samasas. I am not saying it is not possible. You may have two latas, so you may say late, dve late you may say, or in some other flowers that you are talking about. But when person you are addressing, generally you will get in a samasa. And there, let's say when you want to talk about mother and father together, you will say mata pita rau, not mata pita. Pita will decline as Pitru Shabda, will declare as Pita Pitaro Pitaraha. So that Pita Pitarau, second, the first case dual, that first case dual and second case dual also Pitarau, that you will get when you say Mata Pitarau, or two fathers you want to talk about. Let's say there are two children in the class and you say the parents of fathers, both the for the meeting, parents meeting, father has come. I mean, this Rama's father has also come, Shama's father has also come. So you say Pitaru, both fathers have come of both children. But Mata Pitaru is can mean mother and father of a single person. So Mata Pitaru, you will say my mother and father both have come. So when you say mother and father, you will say Mata Pitaru in a samasa, in a compound, which is the second vritti we saw. But there is something called as an ekashesha. Ekashesha, so the rule governs that you cannot say Pita Mataro. You can't have Pita and Mata. Mata cannot come second. Mata is respected. So it will be said that who is more respected, for example, will come earlier. Like between Rama and Lakshmana, you can't say Lakshmana Ramo. You have to say Rama Lakshmanau. Because Rama is elder also. So one way to say elder, the other rule says that more respected. So between the mother and father, it is said that even people say that, the Vedic culture, Hindu culture, they show down the woman. It is not true. You see, Vedic culture, you see, the woman is respected. So, the mother is more respected than the father. And there, it is said, Mata Pitaro. In the rule itself, you see, the Mata Pitaro. But when you drop off, there, the way in English also you say, when you say he, the translation generally you'll say he did this or he goes, but when you say saha, he, that time the she is also included. So it is not he as in gender specific, but you use masculine because in language it is set like that. Across languages you see mostly masculine is used, he pronoun, to convey she also, it is included. Similar in Sanskrit also it is like that. Mata, pitaro, when you say, there ekashesha means one can be dropped in them. And which can be dropped? There you can say pitaro. When you say pitaro, that itself will include mata. Mata is included when you say pitaro. When you say parents, it is, there is no parenting without the mother. So when you say pitaro, the father himself cannot exist without the mother. So in the pitaro, that word itself in dual conveys, can convey two fathers, but it can also have the meaning of mata pitaro. So that is what is called as ekashesha. Ekashesha vritti, where the one word can be dropped and the second word which is retained, that is declined in dual, and it retains the meaning of having the first. So pitaro, what we saw earlier in what we chant, jagatah pitaro vande. So jagatah, jagatah is the sixth case of the pratipadika jagat, of the world. So pitaro, I jagat of pitaro vande, I bow down to, I worship the pitaro, not fathers of the world, not two fathers of the world, but mother and father of the world. So it will mean parents of the world. So pitaro will here in jagat of pitaro vande will mean mother and father both. That is called as ekashesha, because only one remains, and ekashesha vritti means one remains and the meaning of the other is included in the what is retained. That is ekashesha vritti. And then there is something called as a sananta vritti. Sananta vritti. Like krudanta, you have sananta vritti, where the it is a pratipadika plus a pratyaya, sanadi pratyaya, san etc. Sanadi pratyaya will lead to a sananta. And what this means is actually will lead to a dhatu. So now the language becomes wide open. The language itself becomes wide open. That first, in the first case, you derived a pratipadika from a dhatu. I'll just take a couple of minutes. I'm sorry. The pratipadika is derived from the dhatu. Now the dhatu itself can be derived from the pratipadika. And this pratipadika itself we have seen in the four cases. Pratipadika derived from a dhatu. Pratipadika derived from a samasa, as in pratipadika plus pratipadika. And then third we saw pratipadika derived from pratipadika plus a taddhita pratyaya and ekashesha also. Now at least the first three, when you take a pratipadika derived from a dhatu, from another pratipadika putting it together, or from another pratipadika by just adding a taddhita pratyaya, you got another pratipadika. Now all these pratipadikas can form a base to which we add a sanadi pratyaya, is a possibility, and then you can get another dhatu. So plain krudanta pratipadika, krudanta pratipadika can have a, take a san pratyaya or a sanadi pratyaya and give another dhatu, which can further form the base for another pratipadika. So language is so vast that although there are 2200 dhatus, still so many words can be derived, nouns can be derived based on krut pratyaya, based on samasa vrittis, based on taddhita vrittis, and based on sananta vrittis. So there can be more and more pratipadikas and more dhatus, derived dhatus, and these derived dhatus can again form a base for other krudanta pratipadika and so on. And it can form a part of a samasa, it can form for taddhita vritti. All these possibilities are there, and the Sanskrit is tends to infinity kind of words are there. There can be all sorts of words. Of course, they should follow rules as to what can be combined, what cannot. And then there are various samasas also. We'll have a look at the various types of samasas, krudanta, which give the karaka meanings. And we'll look at various types of samasas. Taddhitas will not look much. I'll give a few examples. And then ekashesha will skip, because pitaro, we don't see much of those. We'll see if at all we need it. Sanadi also, I'll just mention it. But we'll look at two in a little detail in the next class, and then we'll move on to Tattva Bodha. So I'll take one class to explain what kind of samasas, the basics of samasas, basics of krudantas, and then some tadita words and some possibility of what kind of meanings are possible, a few of those, couple of examples, and then we'll move on to the Tattva Bodha class proper. Okay. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Any questions? Any questions, comments? Nothing? Okay. So, Sumukhi, you have a question?
Is Tinganta including in this Panchaprati?
No, no, Tinganta is, derivation Tinganta is not included in the, Tinganta is not a, it's not a noun. Here we are looking mostly at nouns. So Panchavritti will mostly talk about nouns. Panchavritti does not include Tinganta.
Okay, thank you.
It's a verb, yeah.
Okay.
Anything else? Anyone else? Okay, so we'll look at, we'll meet in the next class on Wednesday, and hopefully on Friday or next Monday we'll start Tattva Bodha. If we don't have to do summary, maybe on Friday we'll start Tattva Bodha. And for Tattva Bodha class, I'd appreciate that if people can come on time, so we don't have to repeat anything or people don't miss it. So we can start off Vedanta basics and finish Tattva Bodha. So that people can focus more on Bhashya classes, or get started with Bhashya classes and get more benefit from Bhashya classes, or study on their own so that they have a foundation of Tattva Bodha, which is a generic text for Vedanta basics. So you get an overview to move ahead and then approach topics of interest within Vedanta itself. People can take a pick and study whatever their interest is. Once you have a foundation, it is easier. Okay, namaste. Thank you.
I'm going to write down the answer.